So let's start with understanding what is Python and what you can do with the Python and why is it so popular. So you guys are all familiar with other programming languages. I guess a few of you are already familiar with writing programs in C language. So Python is a free and open source software. It is a high level programming language. Okay, and so you don't need to remember. So what do you mean by high level programming language? You don't have to remember the system architecture, and also you need not to do memory management like how you do it in C language or Java, right? You don't have to do it in Python. So this makes it more programming friendly, and it is one of the key features of Python. And also Python was developed by Guido von Rossum in the late 1980s. So what had been developed this Guido von Rossum, he developed a Python, and he developed Python as a hobby project. So what had been developed as a hobby project, now it became a mainstream programming language. Even Google and all the leading companies and even the NASA, they are using Python. Python is also a multi-purpose programming language. You can use Python to develop web applications, and you can develop gaming software, and you can implement machine learning, deep learning, computer vision. You name it, anything, you can do it with Python. Since Python, with Python, the possibilities are endless. Okay, Python is an interpreted programming language. So you must have worked in C and Java language. Those languages are compiled programming languages. So what is the difference between compiled programming language and interpreter based language? Can someone tell me? So in the case of C or C++ or Java, you must first compile your program, and then only you have to run it, right? But in Python, there is no need to compile it. So behind the scene, the Python script is converted into an intermediate form called bytecode. So all you need to do is to run your Python code without worrying about linking to libraries and a few other things, okay? So by interpreted, we mean the source code is executed line by line and not all at once. That is the difference between compiled programming language and interpreted programming language. In the case of Python, it is, since it's being an interpreted programming language, the interpreter executes your script line by line. Whereas in the case of C and Java, C++ languages, it executes your entire program all at once. So that is the difference between interpreted and compiled programming language at a high level. So what is so big deal about interpreted based language? The advantage of this one is it is easier to debug your code. Supposing you are typing a command, right? Then if you press enter, if the syntax is correct, it will get executed, it will throw an output. You can see the output instantly. If there is a problem with your syntax, right? If there is a syntax error or something, it will show immediately so that you can fix it then and there. So that is where the interpreted language is very much helpful. And also the Python supports procedural language, like in the olden days we use something like COBOL and Fortran, and even C language is a procedural language. And also Python supports object-oriented and functional programming. Python is portable and extensible, so this is important. What is portable? Write once and run it anywhere. Once you write a program, Python script, you can run it in any operating system, be it Mac, Linux, Red Hat Linux, or CentOS, or if you have any other Ubuntu Linux, Mac operating system, Windows, you beat any operating system, once you write your script, you just copy paste your script to the new environment or whichever environment you wanted to execute it. You just copy paste it, or you just push your script there, it will get executed. You don't have to make any changes to your Python script in order to execute specific to an operating system. So that is the reason why we call Python as portable. You need to, you write once and run it anywhere. Once you write a script, it can be executed anywhere. So, and also Python can be integrated with other programming languages like C, C++, Java, ActiveX and Corba. And I'll show you with one example with this later point in time, so that you'll be able to understand. And other aspect of Python is it is a dynamic typing. Unlike C and Java, C language, you don't have to declare the variable. You don't need to declare the type of the variable while writing your script. So it doesn't know about the type of the variable until the code is run in Python. So declaration is not required in Python. Just remember this. So what you can do with Python, you can develop a desktop application. So there are some packages, right, in Python, tkinter, you have something called tkinter, using which you can develop a desktop application, and you can develop mobile application, and you can develop a gaming software, and also you can develop other, the GUI based applications, and you can write program to the robot to do some kind of automation, right? And besides this, using Python, you can implement the machine learning algorithm and the state-of-the-art deep learning, computer vision, reinforcement learning algorithms. So you guys must be familiar about the self-driving cars. That is the talk of the town in USA, especially in California. If you see, right, the Google, they have their, they launched the self-driving car. So they've been doing the piloting for quite a longer time, okay? So now it is no longer a sci-fi. A car drives without a driver is no longer a sci-fi. It is a reality. It is a reality, right? So now we can look here. So this is the self-driving car. So this car is bombarded with a lot of sensors. The sensors learn the environment. I learn the outside environment and whatever the information, right, whatever it learns from the environment, it passes back to the algorithm. So in this case, they used reinforcement learning and the combination of deep learning algorithms also, because deep learning algorithms help the car to understand whether the traffic light is red or green or amber sign, amber light, right? So based on which the car can make a decision whether to stop if it finds a red colored stop. So hence it's a combination of, or it's a blend of the deep learning and the state of the art computer vision algorithm. It's a very, look here, right? So automatically the handle, right, the wheel is nothing but the steering, right? It automatically makes the decision which direction it should turn, right? Even if it makes a small mistake, it can run over to another vehicle, right? So here one vehicle is overtaking this car, right? So mistaken if the car moves this side, or or if any other car comes closer to this car, right? If this car makes a small mistake by turning the wheel in the wrong direction, it can lead to a major accident. So it's all possible now with reinforcement learning. Next, we will see what is variables. So what are variables? Any idea? What are variables? As the name suggests, whatever the value you stored in a variable, it will get changed. It will get changed. So we use variables to store the data. It is a container, right? We store the data. It requires a memory space. Right? It requires a memory space based on the type of the value we assign it to them. In simple term, variables are nothing but a reserved memory location to store. In our laptop, we have memory, right? You started your laptop. In the laptop, we have RAM, random access memory. the memory of something like box boss kind of thing, right? So supposing you have a variable called age, and if you assign the value 12 to age, the value 12 will get stored in the memory. To access this value 12, behind the scene, the interpreter uses some reference value, right? So the age uses some reference value using which it can access this value 12. Every value in Python has, data type, right? So how do I define a variable? Look here, on the left side of this assignment operator, this is called the equal sign, is nothing but assignment operator. On the left side of the assignment equal sign, you define your variable. You have to define your variable. On the right side of the equal sign, you need to specify the value. Once you store the value 12 in a variable age, right, the value 12 will get stored in memory. So variables in Python are case sensitive, and there are some naming rules. You should be aware of it while coining the variable names. Right? So you cannot specify the variable name to start with a number. You can only start with a character or an underscores. There are no spaces in the name of the variable. Okay, right. So it should be continuous, or you can use underscore. For example, today underscore date. Instead of saying today space date, right? Today space date, if you specify a variable name, it will not work, it will throw an error. Instead, you can use the underscore. If your variable name is lengthy, right, longer one, then you can use underscore. And also you cannot use special characters like at, not equal, and to, all these special characters you cannot use it while defining your variable. So every value in Python has a data type. Different data types in Python are number data type, and you have something called integer data type, right? Within this numeric data, right, numeric data type, right, you have something called integer and float. As you can see here, the 22 is the whole number. Integer is a whole number. Float is a decimal value, right? It has some decimal values also in it. And booleans also in Python, it is considered as a numeric value. And we have something else called complex number. The complex number will have the combination of both the real and imaginary part. And also we have collections like sequences, mutable, immutable objects, and sets and mappings. All these things we will take a look at it a little later. What we will do is I will jump into the Python Jupyter notebook. That is where you will have to write your program. So before I dive in there, right, so I could see, right, so few of you are, one second, other guys have dropped from this call. Okay, now I'm waiting for them to join. Let them join, because already I explained them how to download. Go to google.com, okay, go to a browser and type google.com and type download Anaconda for Windows 10. Just select the individual edition Anaconda. I think my net, I don't know why my net speed is very slow, though I make the payment on time. One second.
Sir, it's a software or not, sir?
It's like a software. Yeah. It's a software. So to install Python, you need to download Anaconda software. Just go to Google and type download Anaconda for Windows.
Can I do now, sir?
Yeah, go ahead. And others also, please go ahead and do it, okay? Download Anaconda for Windows. Any installation, you can do it along with me, so that you will not miss out. In case of any issues, or if you run into any other issues, right, you can fix it then and there. It's too hot, man, Chennai. I'll just pass the recorder. So you need to have patience. Again, depends on your net speed. I don't know, unfortunately, why it is too slow in my system. Upgraded to the
15 minutes, sir.
Yeah, okay. One of the important step, everyone has to do this. Since we have the freshers and you know the amateurs, right? So they need some time. Let's wait for some time. Enable the recorder. See, once the installation is done, right? So you just click here. I'll go to start button, or here, right? You just type Anaconda. You will find something like Jupyter Notebook, right? Just on the right side of this, click open. So hope all of you are watching here, right? So it opens the command prompt. When you click the Jupyter Notebook, it opened the prompt, right? So it opened the command prompt. So it will take some time. It starts the, you can see something like this. It will take for a while to, so basically what happens here is, it starts the Python kernel. It starts the Python kernel. And you will find lines something like this. Jupyter lab application directory, serving notebooks, Jupyter notebook is running at, and you will find something like this, localhost colon 888 token, something like this, okay? So until you see this, you have to wait. And then followed by this, right, you will find all these things. Importantly, you should see this one. Once this is started, that means you can access the Jupyter notebook. There's something called the Jupyter notebook. You need to start the kernel. This is Python kernel. Once it is done, you need to minimize it. You're not supposed to click cross. So I'm going to minimize this. That means to work on Python, Jupyter notebook, this one should run, okay? You're not supposed to stop this one. Minimize it. Minimize it and keep it aside. And go to your, my favorite browser is Google Chrome. I just go here and type Google, localhost colon 888. So the localhost your laptop, and followed by the colon, you find the four eights, right? So this is nothing but the port number. So this is where the Python is listening, right? So you need to just type it and wait for some time, okay? And this one should run, okay? Just minimize it. So I don't know, so why it takes this much, and usually it will not take this much of time. Okay, let's wait for some time, let's see what happens. So ideally what you need to do is, some guys, they pose mark, you select mark, select the entire line, in, you know, including the token, okay, token, entire line, and go here and edit and copy, and you can paste it here. See, otherwise what will happen, it will ask for the password or token. Since you selected the token also, right, all you need to do is you need to select the entire line, the local host, right, this one, entire line you need to copy, and then you need to paste it here, right click and paste and press enter. Finally you will get only this one, local host colon 883, okay. This is what your Jupyter notebook dashboard, this is called your Jupyter notebook dashboard. Using Jupyter notebook, we can write Python script. Okay, and there are in various other IDEs are available. So IDE, what do you mean by IDE? Integrated Development Environment, right? So IDE is nothing but the Integrated Development Environment. You can use IntelliJ, or you can use PyCharm. PyCharm is also very popular. IDE, so you can click open, right? So community edition, right? You can download community edition. You don't have to worry about this now. Okay, there are various editors are available to write Python program. Even you can use the Notepad. You can use the Notepad to start write your Python program. Okay, for example, a is equal to 2, print a plus 10. You can do this way also. And you can save this as a test 22.py, but you need to save it as a .py file. When you use a notebook, all of you please concentrate here, okay? So test 22.py, right? So what I will do is I will go to command prompt. Yeah, see users welcome, right? So what I will do is I will save this in this folder. So here I saved this one, right? So next one is here, I go here, test 22.py. Yes, it is available. But here I, by specifying Python and test 22.py, if you give like this, it will get executed. But here the Python environment variable, I did not set it in my local system. Hence it says Python is not recognized. But in your system, since you had enabled, you remember not recommended one option was there, right? I told you to check off that one, right? Since you all checked off that one, the environment variable would have been set automatically during the time of installation. Once the installation was successful, you can type the same thing in the command prompt. Go to your command prompt, or you can just open Notepad here also, Notepad, whichever name you prefer it. But the extension should be .py. Type the commands. A is equivalent to print A plus 10. As I told you, on the left side of the equal sign, you need to specify your variable name. On the right side of the equal sign, you need to specify the value. And the print function will help to show what value is stored in A. So, and also we did some arithmetic, right? So we added 10 with the A's value. So 2 plus 10 is 12. It should return 12 here. Anyhow, let your this thing complete. Instead of using the Notepad to write our script, Python script, here in the Jupyter notebook, listen very carefully. On the right side of the Jupyter notebook, you will find something called new. Python 3, you need to click Python 3 to get the blank notebook. This is where you can start write the Python program. Here what you can do is print, so hello world. Look here, so this is called cell, and this is called cell, okay? And in the first cell, I just use the print function. Why I call the function? Because followed by print, I just put the parenthesis, right? This is called your open parenthesis. This is called your closed parenthesis. Inside of this, I mentioned my text value. Print hello world and click this button run. So, right, this one will get executed and it will show the output immediately followed by this one. This is your command. Right, the output of your command, you can see it right below this command, okay? For example, I want to perform 2 plus 2. So 2 plus 2 is 4, right? You can type it something like this. How do I define a variable? A is equivalent to 10, okay? Print A. So I want to check what value is stored in A. So A is 10 and print of A. So the value 10 got stored in a variable A. So A is a container. Instead of saying container, we call that as a variable. In the case of C language and Java language, you need to define the data type of the variable also. Before you assign a value to a variable, you need to tell the compiler what kind of, what data type of that variable is, right? So for example, type int x equal to, or A equal to 10, you need to say something else. But when it comes to Python, you don't have to define or declare your data type for a variable. Directly you can assign a value to a variable like this. I guess all of you are okay with this, right? Fine, so A is equivalent to 10. So next, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to create another variable, B is equivalent to 10. Print B. What value stored in the container B, okay? So it's nothing but a reserved memory, right? So in the reserved memory, in your memory or reserving a place to store the value 10, okay? So A is equivalent to 10 and B is equivalent to 10. Now the next step is how these values are stored in memory. how these values are stored in. See, in our laptop we have RAM, right? So random access memory, and few of you have 4 GB and few of you have 8 GB, and most of you have 8 GB only, I guess. This is what I heard from you guys. So in our memory, right, we have 8 GB RAM just to store one value, right? To store one value, which is nothing but the 10 in your memory, it will not consume right too much of memory. It will consume very less space in the memory. But if I store 10 in the memory, later point in time, if I wanted to retrieve that, right? So I need to use the variable A. If I use the variable A, so what value stored in A, right? So that one will be retrieved. Right, so you need to, this kind of, right, roughly speaking, an address. Actually, I'm not supposed to use address here. Address is different meaning. Okay, here A is kind of your reference. I can't say reference also. It is a variable. This variable uses some reference to access the value 10. You just think that way. Even B, right? So let's say A equal to 10 and B equal to 10. So these two values get stored in the memory. But when it comes to Python, it is not storing these two values two times. It is not storing the value 10 two times in the memory. It stores only one time because both the variables values are same. Why should I store 10 two times in the memory? Unlike in C and other language, in Python, they wanted to use the memory more efficiently. They don't want to store the values redundantly in the memory. Use the memory more optimally, right? You can store additional values in the memory. So what happens here is A is equivalent to 10, B is equivalent to 10. When I use this, for example, I'll just show you here itself. This is called interning, okay? Interning. This is also called as interning. They call it as interning, okay? Interning. So any integer value between 0 to, I guess, 255, I don't remember this number, anyhow I'll confirm this. At this one, you just think 0 to 255 integer values, right? It uses some reference to access the value. For example, in our case, A is equivalent to 10 and B is equivalent to 10. So what happens is, in the memory we have something called boxes, right? Something like the rooms. It is something like, you just think about rooms, right? In our house, you have, let's say you have 4 floors, right? So here it randomly stored this value 10, and this 10 will get stored here. This is A and this is B. But in C language, it used to store the value 10 two times. But when it comes to Python, we have something called interning. What does it do here? The beauty of this one is, the variable A and B, it uses some reference value. It uses some address. It uses some address to access the value 10. So both of them uses, let's say, 3, 4, 5, 6, 11, 2, or 1, 3, 4, 5. This is the reference number. Along with the value in this cell, maintains a reference number. Since the value for A and B are same, it uses a reference number. Both A and B uses a reference number to access the same value. Very beautiful, right? See how they have done it. See, in C and other language, right, so you have to store the value 10 times, right, two times. Supposing you are using 10 in your company for 100 times, right? 100 places it will be stored unnecessarily. You don't have to store redundantly the 10 in the memory. Instead, store it only once, because let's say all the 100 variables are storing the value 100. You don't have to store 100 times. Use this reference. It's something like, the 10 is nothing but you, right? Let's say this is like Deepak. Deepak is, 10 is nothing but Deepak. To access Deepak, or to reach out to Deepak, you need to know his number, right? Door number. Whether postman A or postman B, right? Courier guy A or courier guy B, right? So both these guys, let's say, you ordered a product in Amazon and you gave an address to them. You gave some nothing but the reference number, and you ordered a food via Swiggy. You gave the address to them. So these two guys, they use address to access you. It is that simple. That is what called as interning. So now this one, we will see it now. This is how the memory is managed in Python. For example, to find out the reference value for the A, this is the reference value. You remember I told you here, look here, this is the reference number, right? This is the reference, both A and B uses the reference number to access the value 10. So ID B. So can I say ID of A is equivalent to ID of, you need to use double equal sign, okay? Sorry. True. See, both A and B uses the same reference number, same address to access the value of 10. But inside A 10, so here end of the day, right? Let's say you have C, A, B, C, D, 24 letters, you know, you store value 10, right? Store value 10. And if you want to retrieve it, what will happen is, the 10 will be stored 24 times in the memory unnecessarily. Hope all of you are getting right. The same way you can store the string also. For example, str1 is equivalent to hello. str2 is equivalent to hello. Fine, here if I use ID of str1 is equivalent to ID of str2. It's true, same thing. The same thing is applicable for string also. What is string? To enclose a text value inside the code. So not only text, you can also have numeric value also. But if you specify a numeric value enclosed by code, it will become a string data type. So now the question is, how can I know the data type of the variable str1? There is a function called type. I'll be asking questions, be ready, okay? Type of str1, which is nothing but str. Str stands for string data type. String data type. Supposing I want to store a lengthy one, hello world. Hello world, right? So hello world, and here also I'm going to use hello world. Now let us see, are they true? No, it is not same, right? It is false. It is different. Here also the same thing, right? Here also hello, hello, but the reference number used for str and str same, but here it is not same. Though the string values are same, because it has some limitations. If the string values are too long, see hello is small, right? Only one word. If you store multiple or longer string value, the Python interpreter will not be able to understand this one. Hence, right, it will store these two things in a two different locations or your memory. As a developer, we know these two are same values. Is there any way I can enforce Python to use the reference to access or store the value once, only once? So that multiple way, because multiple variables, here str and str2, both of them are holding these two values. These two values are identical, right? In all the ways. When it comes to case, you know, capital H, rest of them are small letter, space, and capital W, rest of them are small, right? So in all aspects, it is both of them are same, but Python get confused when you use a longer string value, right? So for that, you can use some function in order to enforce, hey, don't store hello world two times and don't get confused. These two are same, okay? So you have something, some function, you have a package called sys. I'll show you later, okay? Let's not get into that now. Just understand, how the values are, how the values are not duplicated in memory, right? Instead, the variables are using the reference number like this. This is the reference. Using this reference number, both the variables are accessing value 10. It is as simple as it. So the same thing is applicable to string, but the limitation with string is If the values are too long, right, the string values are too long, it get confused, but we can still tell Python, hey, these two are same, okay? Hence, you store it only once and use the reference number to access this single value by multiple variables, okay? You can do it that way also. And when it comes to this one, right, 0 to 255, I said, so let's say A1 is equivalent to 500. A2 is equivalent to 500. So ID of A1, thus ID of A1 is equivalent to ID of A2. Sorry, this is A2. You need to be a bit cautious. False. Because as I told you, right, 0 to 255. So there is a limitation here. So any value between 0 to 255, 0 to 255 only, it can use the reference number to access the values. Anything beyond that, it cannot. But still you can use a function. There is a function is available. Using that function, you can enforce the variables to use the reference value to access the, reference number to access the values. So that you can avoid storing the identical values which or the single value used by multiple variable, right? So you can avoid the duplicate of storing the values, right? Using which you can, you have a package, right? Using which you can do it. We will see it little later. So using type function, I can find out what is the data type of the variable. So A is equal to 10. So what is print of A displayed? What value stored in A? And if I want to see the data type of A, it gave me 10. So, int, right? The last one, type of A is nothing, int data type. This is called your int data type. And if you store something like, let's say, you know, A3 is equivalent to 10.234, print A3. And if you type print type of A3, this is called float data type because it has the decimal values in it. Float has decimal values. And you know how to define a string, right? So this is how you need to. So here, when it comes to string, you can use either a single quote or you can use a double quote. But the rule here is when you use the single quote, you need to end with the single quote. If you use a double quote, right, if you start with a double quote, you need to end with the double quote. For example, I am going to use double quote. I started with a single quote, but when I ended with a double quote, it will throw an error. This is an error. Whenever you get this error, right, you should you should be able to understand quickly, hey, I think EOL means we started with something and we ended with something else. You should be very good at debugging also. As a developer, you should be very good at debugging. Whether you're a developer or a data scientist, so you should be very good at debugging the issues also. We don't know when the job will fail in production, right? The lot of jobs will be running. In case you get some error or something like that, right, you should be able to fix it immediately. So by making some mistakes like this, you'll be able to understand, oh man, so this error is related to this one. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with double quote and end it with the double quote. And if I print it, hello world. Now it's cool. Supposing, hello world, hello, welcome to the world of Python. Welcome to the worlds of Python. Look here, I put single quote here. If you want to use a single quote, you need to, enclose your entire string with double quote. And vice versa. Look here, the words, right? The single quote. Supposing you want to use a double quote here, you need to enclose the entire string by what? Single quote. Are you able to follow me or not? here, right? So here, instead of using single quote, I'm going to use double quote. But you need to end with this one. We have some escape sequences. We'll see it a little later. Fine. Look here. Your double quote, right? This is how we can use it. And also, we have something called comment. What is comment? Comment is nothing but comment is a best practice. As a programmer or as a machine learning engineer, or you know, be a Java developer or any architect, in your script you have to specify the comments. The comment should start with a single hash, the number sign. Okay, this also calls a number, and some people they call it a hash. Right? So demonstrate the arithmetic and Boolean operators. Something like that, okay? And here what I do is arithmetic operators. For example, A5 is equivalent to A plus B into 3. So here I'm going to use this one, right? So parenthesis. So B and 3 will get multiplied, and the multiplied, whatever you mention inside the parenthesis, that one will get executed first. You know very well, right? In school mathematics, you know what is baud mass. The same principle is applicable here. We give like this 40. So A is already 10 and B is already 10, right? So 3 into 10, 30 plus 10 is 40, 40 printed. So this one, this line, right? I mentioned about the comment, demonstrate the arithmetic and Boolean operator. Boolean operator I'll show you a little later, okay? So this is comment. The Python interpreter, what it does is, it executes the commands line by line. So when it comes to the first line, as soon as it finds a hash, it will simply ignore this line. It will not execute this line. It will skip this line. It will come to the second line and third line. Since there are no, these two lines are not prefixed with hash, these two lines will get executed. Understood, right? How to specify comment. This is single line comment. Supposing I want to specify multi-line comment. How do I do that? You need to use three quotes. Arithmetic or Boolean, right? So we will explore Boolean data type and the Boolean operators. Later, we will see how to use arithmetic and logical operators. So this is a multiple line, more than one line you have comment. So what you can, for example, I would say this is multiple lines, right? So if you have to specify a comment, you can use single line comment also, right? Hash. But you need to type it four times, hash, 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 hash. Supposing you have 20 lines of comments are there. 20 lines you need to put hash hash. Instead what you do is, right, start with three quotes and end with three quotes. That's all. In between whatever you put it, that will be considered as a text. These text will not get executed by the interpreter. Interpreter will simply skip these lines. As soon as the interpreter see this one, right, it will look out for the next three quote. So, right, when it sees the first time here, right, and as soon as it sees three quotes, it will look out for the next to three codes. So that is the one will closes this one, right? So till this one, it will simply skip that. It will not execute at all. So now you learned how to specify single line comment and multi line comment. We will see doc string. We have something called DOC, doc string. I will show you when I walk you through how to implement a function in Python. Okay, so that time we'll show you how to use a doc string. Okay, doc strings are nothing but the beginning block of you can specify the comment at the beginning of your block of the code. So that is nothing but your doc string. So single line comment use hash, multi line comment you need to use three quotes and end with three quotes, right? This is how you need to specify, and followed by this, if you say, right, so 10 minus 20, so this one will say minus 20, right? So look here. So till then, right? So till then, up to this, right? The interpreter was not at all executing. It skipped it because these are all comments. There's no point in executing comments, right? this is for the for us, right? For the developer to understand what logic you used it, right? So what, for example, yeah, here I mentioned about boolean, right? So what is boolean data type? True. For example, true and false. True and true is equivalent to true. True and true is equivalent to, right? True and true is equivalent to false. What will happen? False. It will say false, right? It is not equal. True and false is not equal. So here I used comparison operator. Double equal sign is nothing but your comparison operator. Single equal sign, here I used it. This is nothing but your assignment operator. You need to remember this. The single equal sign, right? Equal is assignment operator. Operator. If we use double equal sign, right? Double equal is nothing but comparison operator. Comparison operator. Double equal is comparison operator. Single equal is assignment operator. Got it. So this is what called as Boolean values, true or false. Now the question is, as I mentioned in my PowerPoint, the Boolean values also in Python considered as a numerical value. Now let us check that. True is 1 and false is 0. You remember this, okay? Instead of saying true, you can say 1. Instead of saying false, you can say 0. You just think that way. True equal to 1 is same as this one. Let us validate this. Now execute this one. True. So true is equivalent to, this is nothing but true. True equivalent to, true is true. Okay, fine. And now, for example, bool. I have something called bool function. True is equivalent to 1. So this one will return true. The bool function will help us to know what value returned by this one. The bool function will help us to understand what value is returned by this one. Okay. Supposing you have something like age is equivalent to 22, and if you are using if condition, if age is equivalent to 22, okay, and then what you do, print. It's correct. Else, so you need to use, I'll tell you what is indentation in Python. Okay, so here what in the print, it's not correct. First let us execute this one. Line 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? So it, see here I did not specify the code. You have to specify this one in code because it is a comment. We are defining our own, the value, prompt values here. It's correct. It's correct because age equal to 22. Now, I just want to verify what value will be returned by age equal to 22, whether it is a true or false. Print bool of age is equal to 22. Look here. This is true, right? Or else for you to understand the Boolean value return is this one. Look here I use single quote, here I use double, double quote, here I use single quote. The Boolean value returned is true. This is what I said. The bool function helps us to understand what values returned by this condition or the comparison of age is equal. Does age is equivalent to 22, true or false? Yes, it is true. If true, if the condition is true, so this one will return true. If true, do this action, else you do this action. This is how you can define the if else condition in Python. Don't worry, this weekend also I'm going to talk about the conditional control structures. These are called, control structures, the if else and all, okay? because the if else will control the flow of your script or statements. Okay, how to control your flow of statements. If the age is 22, then he is eligible to go for USA for education, higher education. Else he cannot go. Or if experience equivalent to 10 years, more than 10 years, then they are eligible to go to USA, or else they cannot travel. Something like that. You can write your own conditions also here. So okay, now we understood the integer data type. It's a whole number. 500 is a whole number, hence it is an integer. This is a decimal, we call it a float data type, and this is a string, right? String data type, and also Boolean data type, and Boolean data type, right? So, and Boolean operator. What is Boolean operator? For example, I'm going to use AND here, okay? And age is not age, and experience, right? Experience equivalent to 10 year experience. Then for example here, experience equivalent to 10, right? So but here you need to use the double equal sign, don't make this mistake. Okay, exp equal to 10. If I execute this, and what will happen? Yeah, the control, yeah, this person is 22 year old and he has 10 year experience, then it's correct, then he can travel USA, then he is eligible to get his visa stamped, else he cannot travel. So this AND is nothing but Boolean operator. This is called your Boolean operator. So Boolean values are true or false. You can represent the Boolean value in the form of integers also, right? And also, what is Boolean operator, we discussed. And what are the, yeah, and we have something that's called complex data type. Look here, comment, right? Complex data type. Complex data type, it involves, or it is a combination of, both real and imaginary part. Real and imaginary part. It's a combination of both real and imaginary part. So for example, C is equivalent to 10 plus 2J. What is 10? 10 is the real value and 2J is the 2 followed by J, right? So this is the 2, right? Prefixed by J. This is nothing, or this one, right? 2J is nothing but your complex part. The 10 is the real part and 2J is the imaginary part. D is equivalent to 5 plus 1J. Okay, now if I want to see the content of C, and if you want to see the data type of the variable C, right, a type function I have to use, type of C, and I'm going to click run. Hey guys, does the installation got over? Is it still going on? I think but except Praveen, rest of them, they've done it. Praveen, can you please update whether the installation is done or not?
Sir, the installation will be done, sir.
Done, right? Okay, then you can...
Yes, sir. I open the Jupyter notebook and I copied the local host 8888.
Excellent.
Yes.
Okay, you are able to open the blank, this one, right? Notebook?
Yes, sir.
Excellent.
Python
excellent.
3.
Very good, right? So, fine. So, look here. So, what is print C? 10 plus 2J, right? The whatever value on the right side you mentioned, that got assigned to this variable. And what data type is that? It's a complex data type. Even this is also the type of C, right? The C variable is nothing but the complex data type. The data type of this is complex data. This is also complex data type. And here, right, if I add C plus D, what will happen? 15 plus 3J, right? So 10 plus 5 is 15. 2 plus 1 is 3J. So the real part and imaginary part, get added respectively. The real and real part get added, right? So 10 plus 5 is 15. The imaginary part 2 and 1 get added. Now let us do one thing. It's very interesting, right? So C into 2. If I use 2, what happens? 20 plus 4j. When you multiply any value, see, when you add the two complex data type values, the real and real and the imaginary imaginary part get added, right? But when it comes to multiplication, the complex data C, right? C into 2, what happens? 2 into 10 is 20 and 2 into 2 is 4J. This is the difference between addition and multiplication. In the case of multiplication, right, this value get multiplied with both the real and imaginary values. Let us see what happens if I use C divided by 2. Same thing, right? Except the plus, the rest of them, multiplication and division or subtraction, let's do one thing. Subtraction will work as same. C minus D, right? So 10 minus 5 is 5 and 2 minus 1 is 1. And C divided by 2, what happens is it divides both the values. See, the multiplication and division, it happens on both the sides, right? The real and the imaginary part. For example, in this case, the 2 gets multiplied with both the real and as well as the imaginary part. The division, what happens is 2 divided by 10 is 5 and 2 divided by 2 is 1, 1j, 5 plus 1j. C minus D, what will happen? 10 minus 5 is 5 and 2 minus 1 is 1j, right? So 5 plus 1j. So now, because why I demonstrated all these things, or in the case of interview, they, you know nowadays the companies, they don't, the first round of the interview is going to be online test. Or sometimes, right, they will share their screen. Let's say you are in Kuppam, I am in Chennai, I am the interviewer, I will share my screen and I'll ask you to, you know, and I'll ask you to give the answer to this one. What will happen? C into 2, what will happen? C divided by 2, what is the answer? What is the answer? And also I'll be seeing you webcam, via webcam, so that you cannot use mobile phone or other laptop to do Googling. So you need to be very smart in terms of understanding these concepts. Interning, this is called interning, right? Interning memory. What is interning memory? Behind the scene, Python kernel uses the reference to access the values. In case of the integer values are falling between anywhere between 0 to 2 to 55, though you use multiple variables with the same value, right, it will not store the values multiple times, identical values multiple times in the memory. Instead, it will show, it will store only one time, and the variables that are using that same value, it has to use the reference number to access the value. Hope you understood, right? So this is what the data types, these are the data types. Okay, apart from this, we have data type, and also we have something called list, and what else, we have list and tuple, and we have something else called this one, what is that, dictionary. All the sets are there. Anyway, don't worry, I will wrap up in 5 minutes time by explaining the other things. Okay, for example, here str, what is that str? Str1 is hello world, right? I just, okay, here it is, syntax wise it is correct. I'm going to copy paste this one again, and those of you are already opened it, right, you just type it and execute it. So hello world, right? Just type it, this one, and do it. So how do I retrieve the value he alone from the str11? So these values are stored in memory continuously. The h will be stored in memory in a cell, small box, and immediately after the small box, the E will be stored, right? All these values are stored in memory continuously, contiguously, right? So this is how it will store. I'll just show you here. If you store hello world, right? So in the memory, you have something called like this, H, E will also be stored in memory, and L, each letter will get stored in, separate cell, hello, and space is there, right? Separate thing, and W, O, R, L, D. What Python does is, if you want to retrieve a specific value from this string, specific letter, right? Specific letter. For example, I want to retrieve E, right? So these cells are these cells can be accessed. These cells can be accessed via some index values. The index value starts from zero. Behind the scene, in the right Python, it stores the index value 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Right? What is my variable name? This is my variable name str1, right? Str1. If I want to access this one, you can use this reference value to access. Use this index value. This is called your index value. Or you can say, you know, the reference value, right? So index value. str1 of 1. So in this address, right, in this address, who is living? E. str of 1 will give you E. You will see that here, okay? So this is called slicing. Slicing the string values, right? str11, okay, in this case, str11. For example, if you wanted to retrieve E1, because in the 0th position, this guy lives, and the one position, the E is there. Look here. So in the 0th position, H is there. In the first position, the index 1 refers to points to E. If I give, what happens? 1, right? E. Look here. This is how I access it. Similarly, if I want to access the O, O multiple times are there. What we will do is we will access D. How do I access D? str11. Since this is the last letter, what in minus 1. On the left to right, the index values are start from 0, 1, 2, 3. But right to left, if you want to traverse, right? Minus 1, the index values start from minus 1. Minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. Minus 1 if I give D. See, if I give str11 minus 2, it will give me this L, right? This L. So minus 1, minus, if you come from right to left, but if you traverse from left to right, you need to use str11 of 1 or str11, okay. Supposing I want to retrieve ELLO, how can I do that? str11, you need to start with the value, right? So the first position E is there, and end with, say, 0. 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Yes, you are correct, Deepak. 5, right? So this is how we need to specify. CLO. So you must be wondering why 5? Why can't it be 4? This is the start index value. Colon. Colon is nothing but range of value, right? Range of value. And end index value minus 1. You understood, right? Please try this one. All of you try this one. Type it quickly. Are you all getting the same value? Okay, it's, I'm getting disturbed from my people, my office people. They are sending a lot of messages to my email ID. What we will do is we will wrap up this session as of this one. We'll continue the rest from this upcoming weekend. The upcoming weekend night, right? Saturday, Sunday, we'll start by, this weekend we'll start by 9 p.m., okay? 9 p.m., both the Saturday and Sunday will start. I will send you the meeting invite sometime this Saturday afternoon or so, okay? Any of Saturday night only the session is, right? Saturday and Sunday between 9 to 11 p.m. night it will be there. So we will manage this time for the next 2 weeks. Later on, what we'll do is there are some working professionals out there. They said they requested me to shift it a little earlier because the weekend they want to go to bed early, because all the 5 days, they are staying, they are working day and night. So they wanted to take rest at least during the weekend. Hence, they wanted me to prepone the session. So that we will discuss it later. See, as of now, this Saturday and Sunday, the training time will start by 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. Start and end by 9 to 11 p.m. Okay. So don't forget to join the session. Anyhow, I'll send you the meeting invite. You can join, but don't miss out any of my sessions. Okay. Anyhow, I will store this one. New batch, something like that. Okay. So I will